Well, we are now in this time of Palm Sunday. This is often what we call this Holy Week, where we celebrate so many of the events in Scripture that lead us entirely to the cross of Jesus Christ. Today we're going to be talking about not only Palm Sunday and his entrance into Jerusalem, but really focusing in on the fact that Jesus came to be the Lamb of God. Lamb of God. Wow. Okay. Let's not assume we know anything about that. In fact, let's go back and take a deeper look at what this lamb was all about. In order for us to really get a handle on this, we need to look way back, back even to the time of Abraham, where God set the standard of a sacrifice to help remove our sin. And the reason he did this is because, honestly, sin is a big deal. We need to take sin as a big deal. Here in the post-New Testament era, we have a tendency to take that for granted. But we can't truly understand what Jesus did on the cross if we don't have the understanding that God takes sin seriously. Ultimately, we need to wrap our minds around the fact that sin equals death. Sin is death. But God loves us so much that God figured out a way for us to avoid that death. And in some ways he said, if something else will die on your behalf, then I will count that against your sin. So God established this idea of sacrifice, a blood sacrifice. In other words, something had to die. And maybe you've remember reading in the Bible or hearing about where they would take an animal, sometimes as small as a dove, maybe a lamb, sometimes oxen, to shed the blood on the altar, to take the place of our death. Well, you know, there's a big honking theological word for that, okay? Are you ready? You don't need to write this down. There will not be a test. But the big word for that is sacrificial atonement, okay? So in other words, some part of our sin was atoned for, made up for, by the sacrifice of another animal. And that was true for a very long time throughout the Old Testament. We saw one time where Abraham went to go sacrifice Isaac as a great sacrifice, but God stopped and he sacrificed a ram. We also have seen where the temple, where the glorious temple was consecrated, and literally thousands of animals were sacrificed at that time. The only problem with that sacrificial system is that each one of those animals was not good enough. Are you ready for this? Not good enough to erase all sin from all people for all time. God knew that when this was all started. God also knew a very important truth, that all the animals in the world would not be good enough to erase the sins of a human being. In fact, not even a human being sacrifice would be good enough to cleanse the sin of all people for all time, because human beings are sinful. The only one that could really be the true Lamb of God that takes away all the sins was God himself. So when Jesus, the Son of God, the very person of God, became flesh, he was meant to be the sacrificial lamb, the ultimate blood sacrifice, that sacrifice would be good enough to erase all sin of all people for all time. I know that sounds really gruesome on this side of the cross, doesn't it? In fact, all of this, all the talk of blood and the altars and things like that seem terrible. only because we live on this side of the resurrection. We live on this side of the cross. We live on this side of love and grace, so we no longer need to deal with that kind of sacrificial system because Jesus paid it all. But the moment we take that for granted, then we have a tendency to think sin is no big deal. But it really was, and it really is a big deal. The only difference is Jesus paid the price. So Jesus came to be the Lamb of God. Yeah, we understand that now. But what I'd like to take a look at is the magnitude of that. I'd like us to take a look at how important that really was. By taking a look at the crowds of people, even at the time of Jesus. You remember Jesus when he made his entrance into Jerusalem, and what a great thing that was. The crowds of people cheered Jesus as the new king. They wanted him to be the king of Israel, the king of the Jews, and hopefully he would have this power as a king and maybe even push out the Romans so that they would be free once again. They rejoiced in the possibility of a king to make their lives better. The story goes something like this, right out of Scripture. It says he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives. And the whole crowd of disciples began to joyfully praise God in loud voices for all the miracles that they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." In other words, they were saying, "Tell your people to shut up. They're being too loud and rowdy." That's in the Phil Schmidt translation. Look it up sometime. That's about what it is. And then Jesus said this, "I tell you, if they kept quiet, his disciples, then the stones themselves would cry out." You see what's wrong with this picture? The people who gathered around to cheer Jesus coming into Jerusalem, they were cheering who they thought would be a king who might push out the Romans and make their lives better. So their praise was only temporary. As a king is only temporary. But if the people were to remain silent, the stones themselves knew very well, the whole earth knew very well that they were in the presence of the Creator. And when they were in the presence of the Creator, if the people didn't cry out, the stones would, because they knew better that this was not just a king, this was the Creator of all the universe was right here with them. What a great way to start this week, right? Unfortunately, it didn't last. Remember I told you about the sacrificial system, right? That they would come to Jerusalem, they would come to the temple and come to the altar, and they would have these blood sacrifices. Well, there was this once a year when Jews from all over, not just Jerusalem, not even just all over Israel, but all over the world, would make their pilgrimage. And frankly, some of them took a really long time to get there. And I gotta tell you, if you had to tow along a lamb with you, that might be kind of a pain, right? So what they did is they bought a new lamb right there in Jerusalem. In fact, where else would you buy a lamb except right there in the temple? So over the years, the temple, this place of prayer, turned into a place where you could buy a sacrifice. And as long as you're buying a sacrifice, you come from another country or another region, you may want to exchange some money so that you can be able to trade with the local people for quite a profit on the money changer's part. And as long as you have sacrifices, maybe you ought to have some food or trinkets. Next thing you know, the temple, which is supposed to be the holiest place, is now scattered with people trying to make a profit. Now remember, Jesus Christ is the one whom the stones would shout out because he is the creator. Can you imagine if the Lord made flesh came to the temple and saw his house of prayer turned into a marketplace? It was with righteous and holy indignation that Jesus came in, turned over the tables, and got people out by making a whip made of cords and says, you need to get out of this place, for this is the house of the Lord. There were some people who were not very happy about that, and they weren't the merchants. Funny thing, the people who hated it the most were the religious people. Because if, after all, if you want to sell your wares in the temple, I get a little bit. Now Jesus drove off those people. Now they didn't get their money anymore. Now keep in mind, this isn't the only reason. The Pharisees were looking for a reason to silence Jesus for some time, but this became the perfect excuse to get rid of Jesus. And how do you really get rid of Jesus? We gotta kill him! I know you've heard that part of the story before, but let this sink in for a minute. Sometimes we take that for granted. Can you imagine church people being so angry today that they're going to go off and kill people? What are you, nuts? At the time of Jesus, it was just as wrong. But they made some trumped up charges. They bribed one of Jesus's closest companions to get him in a place where the crowds wouldn't be around, because if they tried to arrest him with the crowds there, it would have turned into a nightmare. So they came in and they grabbed Jesus when they was all alone with just he and his close companions. Peter wasn't going to stand for it. You know, Peter took out a sword and says, "Don't worry, Jesus, I got this." And you know, Peter, he was a fisherman, right? He wasn't a soldier. So he took a swipe at one of the soldiers, and he didn't do a very good job. In fact, all he did is cut off his ear. And then Jesus says, "Enough of this." And even then, when he was about ready to be arrested and tortured and killed, he had enough compassion to heal the soldier who was taking him away. Could you do that? I don't know if I could. To make a very long night short, Jesus was taken to the Sanhedrin, the ruling court of the Jews, and they sentenced him to death, but they couldn't carry it out. So they took him to the Roman governor, Pilate, who had the authority, and Pilate says, hey, don't talk to me, go talk to the king. So he sent him off to King Herod. King Herod wanted to see a bunch of magic tricks. Jesus wouldn't play along with it, so he sent him back to Pilate. Now Pilate has this man before him that he doesn't really want to kill. He doesn't want to cause a ruckus. So what's he going to do? What's he going to do to keep the crowds from rebelling? Well, he says, hey, at this particular day, the crowds have the right to set one person free. So he says, how would you like to set free Jesus? Yay! Or you could set free, who's the nastiest guy we have in prison, he asks. He says, there's this dude Barabbas. Okay, not only was he arrested for insurrection, but he's a murderer. We'll put the murderer up against Jesus. Surely you'll release Jesus, right? The same crowds who cheered Jesus coming into Jerusalem as king, those same crowds called out for Jesus to be crucified. This part of the story goes like this. But the whole crowd shouted, "Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us!" Barabbas was thrown into prison for insurrection to the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate tried to appeal to them, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him!" How did they go from Hosanna to crucify him in such a short period of time? It's because they thought he was a king who could make their lives a little better. And now it doesn't seem like that's going to be the case. But you know, there's also this mob mentality that we are susceptible to as humans. Am I right? It's easy to shout, "Yay, football player, music star, Hollywood hero." But isn't it more fun to tear someone down? Isn't it more fun to join around with the crowd as they kick someone when they're down? Isn't it more fun to shout, "Crucify him"? Long story short, Jesus was beaten 39 times, the legal limit. He was forced to carry his own cross with a crown of thorns that shoved into his head. He carried the cross for as long as he could possibly carry it, and he fell with exhaustion. They forced a man named Simon of Cyrene to carry Jesus' cross. They brought it to this place. It's called Golgotha, or known as the skull. Isn't that terrible? And the Bible said they crucified him. Our definition of crucifixion in our modern language is like, this guy was crucified, which means, oh, people made fun of him and teased him and they dragged their name through the mud. I don't think we easily wrap our mind around what crucifixion really was. First of all, the Romans really knew how to crucify people because they'd been doing it a long time and they were terribly efficient at it. One of the things that a good Roman soldier knew how to do was to take the beams, and by the way, the beams would be significantly larger than this. And they would lay the person to be crucified down upon the beams, and they would drive the nails into their wrists, most likely. You notice I say wrist and not hands, because scientifically that is the best place to put a nail. If you're going to crucify someone, you don't want to waste your time. Now, in fact, if you want to feel your own wrist for a second, there are two bones, the radius and the ulna, and they come together at the hand. Can you feel that little gap there? Ooh, what a great place to drive a nail. By the way, it's a misconception that the nails killed him. No, the nails just held him in place. In fact, early on, the Romans would often tie ropes around the person's arms to hold him in place. You see, you don't die from any of the crucifixion. You die from suffocation. When you are strapped up with your arms up, it makes it harder to breathe. In fact, if you were just strung up by your arms, you would be dead in a matter of minutes. Oh, but the Romans, they knew how to do this. They were efficient, and they knew that if they put a nail between their feet or through their feet, the dying man would instinctively push off of the nail in his feet just to take one more breath. So the nails didn't kill Jesus. The nails just held him in place. That way, he wouldn't die in a matter of minutes. If they were lucky, it would take him days to die. The Roman soldiers took a nail, put it through his wrist, and drove it down deep through the wood. To the other hand as well. And finally, through the feet, to allow him time enough to suffer. Four Unfortunately, Jesus was beaten within an inch of his life. He was on the verge of death by the time he took up the cross. So Jesus died in a matter of hours, not days. I'm not sure if there's a worse way to die, but honestly, I don't want to know about it. The one thing I want all of us to understand, that Jesus came to be the Lamb of God. He came from heaven to earth to be that sacrifice. Jesus did not come to earth to teach and to heal, and somehow, by some misunderstanding, he got strung up on the cross. This did not come as a surprise to him. He came willingly. He went willingly to the cross of Jesus Christ. He went willingly to Golgotha. And to the same crowds who gathered around, even at the end, while Jesus was hanging there, he showed them grace. It's recorded like this. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. And they divided up his clothes, and they cast lots, and the people stood around and watched, and the ruler sneered at him, and they said, save yourself. Let him save himself if he is truly God's Messiah, the chosen one. So here we have the people watching you as you're hanging on the cross, sneering at you. Would you have what it takes to say, Father, forgive them? I think I'm a pretty nice guy. I think I'm a pretty decent man. But I don't think I could do that. But remember, Jesus came to do that. That's why Jesus came from heaven to earth, full of love, and full of grace, to be the Lamb of God. I'd like to share with you this song that tells a beautiful story told from the perspective of Simon of Cyrene. We don't know his full story, but this might help us to understand just a little bit. Would you turn off the lights?
Time had come to sacrifice again. My two small sons, they walked beside me on the road. The reason that they came was to watch the Lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. For there will be so many in Jerusalem today. Must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. And I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. Now when we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why were we standing here where soon they would pass by? I looked and said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy, the people gave him none. The second one was violent, he was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus. I scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross, falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled, I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back, the crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, to resist him. Then his hand reached for his sword, and so I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder and started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. And yet upon the cross, I heard him pray, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit, he prayed, and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I'd lost all sense of time, until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, Father, please forgive us. The lamb ran away. Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much that we don't understand. So I took them in my arms, and we turned and faced the cross. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb.
See, Jesus came to be the Lamb of God, but a willing sacrifice. And not only a willing sacrifice, but so full of grace that sometimes it's hard to wrap our minds around that. Sometimes it's hard to wrap our minds around the fact that those same people who called for Jesus as king, called him to be crucified, the same crowds, he said, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing. Oh, so full of grace. But you know, that's why he came. This didn't happen by accident. This was all a part of the plan. Even from the very beginning, John the Baptist said of Jesus, way back in John 1, he said, the next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him, and he said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus was the great Lamb of God because he was God in the flesh. He was willing because it was part of the plan. And he did this, not just for the crowds who were present there that day, but seeing into the future, he did it for us. He did it for you. For us to truly appreciate his sacrifice, we need to understand its importance. I hope everyone knows this, that no matter what you've done, no matter who you are, no matter how hard it is for you to think that you are worthy, I can assure you, from the person of Jesus Christ himself, you are joyfully forgiven. We are forgiven. And I think only then may we cheer and praise his name, not as a king, but as a savior. And that, my friends, makes all the difference. In just a few minutes, we're going to pray together. And as we pray together today, if you want to ignore me and just spend time with you and your Savior, nothing would please me more. But I hope that most of us would be able to come before the Lord, open our hearts, and ready ourselves to fully receive what Jesus has to offer. Forgiveness forever. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your amazing sacrifice on our behalf. We thank you, O Lord, that you made the plan to come to earth. We thank you, O Lord, that you made a way for us to be forgiven by you becoming the Lamb of God who takes away not just the sins of the world, but my sin, yes, even mine. And I am free from the law of sin and death. For that, Lord, we give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. We thank you that you have come to earth to rescue us. We thank you for this in Jesus' glorious name. Amen.